trees and songbirds thrive there among willows, alders, and bald cypress. You might have noticed the dramatic rock outcroppings on either side of the tram. These natural formations are 500 million years old and are present throughout the garden.
As we approach the stop, on side B, you'll see the 11-acre azalea garden with nearly 1 mile of meandering woodland paths.
Features a diverse collection of nearly 3,000 North American, Asian, and European azaleas and rhododendrons. Chosen for the intensity and duration of their blooms, a variety of species is planted in the shade of native oaks, tulip trees, and sweet pears. While the crescendo of pink, white, and lavender flowers is at its peak in May, broad sweeps of beautiful woodland wildflowers provide color for much of the year.
Including the 50-acre Thane family forest you see on side A, the New York Botanical Garden is home to over 1 million plants. But even more, it's where plants...
As we turn, look up the road on side B. The grove of small trees on the slope is the garden's crabapple collection, including over 90 varieties. The trees flower abundantly in late April. Also on side B, in the grassy triangle, there stands an enormous black oak. It's nearly 200 years old.
As the tram stops on the bridge, look out on side A. On the riverbank, you can see the Lillian and Amy Goldman Stone Mill. Built in 1840, it's a National Historic Landmark and a New York City landmark. The Lorillard family, who once owned the land which the garden now occupies, made their fortune in the tobacco industry. This mill was used to create snuff, a popular alternative to smoking tobacco.
In European settlers, the Bronx River provided food and water for the valley. The river is also a vital economic resource for the local Americans. By the mid-1700s, its steady flow was furnishing hydropower to 12 mills.
We are now entering one of the most spectacular collections of rare and unusual garden conifers in America, the Benenson Ornamental Conifers. From 2000 to 2004, the garden completely restored this picturesque 15-acre site and added more than 250 new conifers to the collection. Whether surrounded by the vibrant greens of spring and summer, the earth tones of autumn, or shrouded in winter snow, this collection's unique beauty is stunning throughout the year.
Immediately after the stone and cedar pavilions, look on side A for a cluster of thin, unusual-looking trees. They are weeping giant
greenhouses for living collections. Here, the garden develops its living collections, propagates plants for exhibition, and grows plants under specialized conditions for study, research, and conservation. In 8 distinct growing zones, staff members cultivate alpine, desert, tropical, cloud forest, and temperate plants that are displayed throughout the garden. The garden grows and cares for over 1 million living plants. Seasonal exhibitions alone can require upwards of 13,000 plants grown from seeds or cuttings. It's an enormous task, but the Nolan greenhouses make it possible. In this cutting-edge research facility, plants are also grown for scientific study. In its role as an international plant conservation rescue center, the garden nurtures thousands of rare and endangered plants. The greenhouses include the Burke Sullivan Display House, where you can view special exhibits and see how horticulturists grow the plants that populate much of the garden.
I think 进去转了一圈嘛。
Ornamental conifers. Straight ahead is the Adam R. Rose and Peter R. McQuillan Horticultural Operations Center. This facility has received silver level leadership in energy and environmental design certification. The stone cottage to the right of it once served as the gatehouse on the Laurelard estate.Beyond the rock outcroppings on Side B is a wonderful planting of herbaceous and tree peonies that flower beautifully in May. That's the Hope Peony Collection.
On the same side and down a gentle slope is an ancient lake bed, now the award-winning Peggy Rockefeller Rose Garden. It's planted with nearly 4,000 roses in over 680 varieties.They bloom magnificently in June and continue flowering through September. The formal rose garden was designed in 1916 by Beatrix Ferrand, who achieved fame as a landscape architect in an era when the profession was almost exclusively male. But Ferrand's vision for the garden wasn't fully realized until 1988.When the Rose Garden was finally completed with support from David Rockefeller in honor of his wife, Peggy.
Beyond the Rose Garden is the Lilac Collection, which was established in the late 1940s with hundreds of plants from the breeding collection of T.A. Havemeyer, a distinguished horticulturist. Each spring, this corner of the garden comes alive with lilacs in colors from white and pale blue to lavender and deepest purple.
On side A is the cherry collection. In the first warm days of the stop, on side A is the Ruth Ray Howell family garden, marked by the long, low brick wall.
On side B, look for a tree surrounded on three sides by a low stone wall. It's a majestic turkey oak.On either side of the road, you'll see magnolia trees. In early spring, they explode with pink and white flowers.
In a few moments, we'll once again be crossing the Bronx River. Originating in Westchester County, it is the city's only freshwater river. Once, it was lined with factories, tanneries, and mills. Most are gone now, and the water quality has improved.Attracting many birds and other wildlife. In addition to the river, the 50-acre forest we've been passing on Side A is important both historically and ecologically. It's the largest surviving stand of uncut, first-growth timber in the metropolitan area. Today, the forest remains in its natural state, although it has been subject to many unnatural human disturbances.To combat threats to its ecosystem, the garden is deeply involved in continuous restoration and stewardship of the forest through the removal of invasive species and the planting of native trees, shrubs, and wildflowers.
Ahead on Side B, you'll see an arched stone bridge. That area is called Twin Lakes for the lakes on either side of that bridge. A century ago, it was a lively spot for ice skating in winter.While there's no more skating, the lakes are still popular with water birds and seasonally migrating flocks. On our free Saturday morning birdwatching tours, garden visitors have spotted more than 200 species. Again on Side B is a group of modern buildings, which includes the Pfizer Lab, home of the Lewis B. and Dorothy Coleman program for molecular systematics.And the largest and finest research laboratory in any botanical garden in the nation. Here, experts study the genealogy of plants and fungi. Much of the garden's primary plant research takes place in the nearby William and Linda Steer Herbarium, which houses more than 7 million dried specimens, some dating to the 1700s. The garden's research and conservation programs are among the most comprehensive and far-reaching in the world.Areas of research include plant molecular biology, natural resource management, and habitat preservation.
Our programs stimulate discussion and disseminate information in order to help develop effective responses to environmental challenges. In fact, this tram runs on clean, natural gas, reducing emissions and air pollution. We thank Con Ed for their sponsorship of this effort to protect the environment and human health.
The inspiration for the New York Botanical Garden was the magnificent Royal Botanic Gardens at Kew outside London. The New York Botanical Garden's first director visited Kew with his wife during their honeymoon in 1888. On their return, they successfully lobbied for a New York garden of equal beauty. In 1891, the New York Botanical Garden was incorporated by the state legislature with the intention of being a public botanic garden of the highest class. 4 years later, the founders selected this site, which had already been purchased by the city of New York, and enlisted Calvert Vaux, co-creator of Manhattan's Central Park, as the chief designer. The founders recognized that the property was blessed with a variety of microclimates for growing plants, and they also knew that the city's remaining wilderness was fast disappearing, so they set out to preserve it too.
As we turn off the main road, we'll be driving through two rows of American tulip trees planted over a century ago. A tree-lined walk like this is called an allée. At the end of the allée, you'll see an impressive building with massive columns and wide steps. Completed in 1901, it houses the Lewester T. Mertz Library. With over 1 million documents, the oldest more than 800 years old, the Mertz Library is the largest and most important collection of literature about plants in the world. Scientists travel from across the globe to conduct research here. The library's Rondina and LaFaro Gallery presents several exhibitions each year. Inside the library building, you'll find a display of stunning orchids in the first floor rotunda. In the Britain Science Rotunda and Gallery on the fourth floor, you can explore a fascinating exhibition devoted to 10 current research projects of the garden scientists.
Magnolia collections, you'll find thousands of individual specimens of unusual trees from around the world. After we've turned out of the allée of tulip trees, you'll see a collection of pines and other cone-bearing plants from the northern temperate regions on side B. That's the Arthur and Janet Ross Conifer Arboretum. Just out of view on side B of the tram is the Botanical Garden's crown jewel, the Enid A. Haupt Conservatory. It is the preeminent Victorian-style glasshouse in America. A grand structure of glass and iron, it opened in 1902. Thousands of plants thrive in its 11 galleries, in habitats ranging from tropical rainforest to American desert. Ahead, on side A, is the Rock Garden, featuring a tremendous diversity of unusual plants from the world's mountain regions. Straight ahead is the round reflecting pool. It marks the path to the Leon Levy Visitor Center. Don't miss Shop in the Garden, where you can find gardening products, plants, and elegant gifts, and the best selection of gardening books in America.
If you enjoyed your visit, remember, we can credit a portion of today's ticket toward a membership. See any ticketing window for more details. To our current garden members, thank you for your support. From the tram, you've only glimpsed the Botanical Garden's riches. We invite you to explore the grounds on your own and share the beauty, excitement, and surprises waiting for everyone here at the New York Botanical Garden.